This is without question a bucket list pass, and if you're a gravel pass aficionado, then doubly so. After the long flat plains of the Coobockerveld have been traversed, this pass comes as something of an eye-opener as the summit is approached and suddenly the whole pass is there winding its way laboriously down the western flank of the big ravine carved out by the perennial Leo Rivier in the southern Cederberg. It ends at a delightful camping spot named Bali's Hut. This road is not for the faint-hearted, as it is single width only, and many parts of the road are propped up by some very basic dry-packed stone walls. These are more or less in the fashion of Thomas Paine's dry-packed walls, but the construction work itself is much more rudimentary. To access this pass, you first have to cross the Tandfontein Farm, which is a partially deep-reclaimed road and has certain restrictions and requirements. The road is closed by a boom and there's a guard hut on the left which is permanently manned. The Tandfontein Farm is one of many owned by the De Tooy Group who produce food for South Africa from the Coobockerveld all the way through to the Langkloof in the Eastern Cape. Here is an example of highly skilled and professional farming methods being employed. As the Tandfontein Road has been partly deep reclaimed, the landowner imposes certain restrictions on vehicles using the road. These are clearly explained on the notice board and include not allowing any firearms. From the boom control point, drive directly along a straight gravel road into the northeast for 3.5 kilometers to arrive at the start of the pass at the point where there are some beautifully weathered Cederberg sandstone formations, with some of the huge rocks teetering and appearing as if they could topple over at any second, and this is possibly where the Tandfontein name originates from. The road now degenerates into a two-spur track and winds its way through the rocks and amongst a stand of blue gum trees. Some outbuildings and construction equipment appear on the left. There are several tracks and it's quite difficult knowing which is the correct one, but they all rejoin again within a short distance. The track then drops through a number of short level areas and suddenly the trees open up, revealing a huge rugged and deep valley that appears directly in front of you, where the lower portion of the pass can be seen winding its way down the mountainside on the left. It takes about 20 minutes to descend the 205 meters over a total distance of 2.4 kilometers, which produces an average gradient of 1 in 12, but there are some serious gradients which get to 1 in 6, plus it's a very bumpy and rocky road. Ideally a 4x4 is required, and especially the climb back out of the valley is much better done in low range. If you're towing a trailer or an off-road caravan, then low range is a definite requirement. The road swings away to the right and follows the rim of the canyon for a short while before turning through a 180 degree hairpin bend. A small notice board advises drivers to scan the pass for ascending vehicles and to wait at the solitary widening of the road for that vehicle to pass safely. The spot is in any case the perfectly level and safe place to stop to take photos. The scene here is vast and dramatic, with jagged ridges and peaks forming a massive frame over the deep cleft below where the Leo Rivier runs placidly into the north. Deep and clear rock pools glisten like pearls as they link the run of the river all the way down the valley. Almost the entire road can be clearly seen from this point, making it the perfect holding spot. There's a similar spot near the bottom for ascending vehicles to wait for those descending. Don't think that you'll find a space wide enough for safe passing, as the entire road is strictly single width and trying to pass another vehicle will be extremely dangerous as the drop side of the road is completely unguarded. The recorded history of Bali's Hut starts when a surveyor by the name of Bailey came across the deep and remote valley in the southern Cederberg in approximately 1885. Over time, the Afrikaans-speaking families that settled on this patchwork of fertile farms referred to it as Bali's Hut. After the Hanekom family originally owned the land, it was later divided into two farms in 1915, one for Piet Esterhazen and the other for Karel Nevoet. Around this time, one of Karel Nevoet's daughters married a certain Botma, and four generations later, his great-grandson, Marius Botma, still farms here. The farmers have crops and fruit trees that keep them busy throughout the year. In the summer there are oranges as well as peaches and pears, most of which are dried using the traditional methods to retain their sweetness. We had to wait about 10 minutes for the driver of this rig, who used low range capability of his vehicle and ascended the pass slowly, precisely controlling power and traction. It is possible to drive this pass in a 4x2 vehicle, but high clearance is a definite requirement. We also strongly advocate the practice of lowering tire pressures for improved traction, a softer ride, and the reduction in the likelihood of picking up a puncture. Be sure to watch part 2 of the Pit Estés and Pass.